Well, hello and good afternoon and welcome to our penultimate Assembly of Term. And I'm really delighted that this afternoon, two things really. One, we're joined by Mrs Wright, who's going to talk to us about managing change within our lives and the whole process of transitioning. And also the fact that this afternoon we have the orientation session in the junior school for years 2, 3, 4 and 5. So how thrilling it is to have them back with us. Now, out of the camera shot here is actually my daughter, Caitlin, and she's getting on with some of the work which throughout all of this time, Mr. Pendlebury has been setting her. And whilst I love having her here with me, I know that she's very, very excited to be seeing all of her friends for the first time this afternoon after what has been a period of over 3 months apart from each other. So this is a very happy day indeed in that regard. Yesterday, of course, was Father's Day. And Father's Day is a day which really can, I think, conjure up very mixed emotions for us, depending upon what stage we're at in our lives. And certainly when I was growing up and having lost my father at the age of 6, it was a day really which often filled me with a sense of sadness. Obviously, we were very, very thankful for the time that we had with him. But ultimately, it was also a day about remembering rather than more thinking about the here and now. And one of the joys that I suppose of going through life is that our perspective on things like that change as we get older. And now as the father of 3 daughters, I really feel that I'm able to enjoy Father's Day in a way which as a child myself I found it difficult. But, and I think this is the important thing, is that we all live in different family structures, and we all have different people who care for us and love us and nurture us when we're young, and they don't stop doing so when we grow up either. I think it's really important, whatever name we give to a day, whether it's Mother's Day or Father's Day, whatever we call it, it's really good for us to pause and to take that time to say thank you to the most important people in our lives. One of the ways in which my middle daughter, Caitlin, wanted to say thank you to me. She wanted me to go to a dance class with her yesterday. Now, she's 7 years old and she likes dancing. I'm obviously many, many years older, and I am probably the most uncoordinated person that you could possibly ever imagine meeting. If you think, you know, fathers don't get a good reputation, do they, for dancing? And I'm really a very prime example of why that is the case. So what we thought we'd do is we have got a little video of this incident. It doesn't just feature me, it features Mr. Clark. It also features Mr. Shaw as well. And out of shot is the wonderful choreographer, Gemma Shaw. And she put us through our paces. And I think that you would conclude when you watch this that I'm no natural dancer, but hopefully it'll bring a smile to your face and brighten your day, although I promise it's not something I'll ever share with you again. So have a really enjoyable week. I know year 10, year 12, you're now back in full lessons for the last couple of weeks of term, and 7 to 9 obviously have an activity week. So enjoy yourselves, whatever you're doing, and we will make sure that we have a very special assembly next week as we then prepare for the summer holidays. Thank you.
Saturday was our summer solstice day, and the sun, as though it knew what a special day it was, the longest day of the year here in the Northern Hemisphere, shone brightly and warmly, setting well beyond 9 p.m, settling among the reeds just outside of the school and casting a golden path across the water all the way down to the horizon. Yesterday was also Father's Day here in the UK, a day for celebrating fathers and fatherhood, a day that for some is full of joy and for others is bittersweet. One of the pupils, James Wood, decided to use this as an opportunity to write and perform a poem in which he explains what his family means to him. Here at Rossall, as Mr. Quartermain has said, some of our resident fathers took the opportunity to spend quality time with their children, marking the occasion with a special dance lesson. Do stay tuned to watch their performance later on in this assembly. Meanwhile, our junior school pupils will have probably been preparing happily for their return to school today. We welcome back virtually all of our pupils and celebrate in so doing another significant milestone. Last week, the Year 10s also had the opportunity to come into school, and it was heartwarming to see them and talk to them face to face. The joy in the mundane routines of sitting in a classroom, spending break time chatting to friends, and the inevitable spontaneity that can only come from being in each other's company was clear to see. A few of them had decided to tell us what this meant for them, and what follows is a short clip where some of them share their highlights. The past week, all of our pupils have been working exceptionally hard, whether preparing for and sitting their Key Stage 3 exams, or engaging in our enrichment programme in Year 10 and Year 12, or sampling our sixth form courses through the pre-sixth form programme. In Year 10, pupils have been thinking about how the events of the past few months will shape the world and future through the Time Capsule project. They've also had the chance to explore potential careers and have taken part in virtual study skills workshop. Our Year 12s have been tooling up to make the most of their UCAS application, and Mr. Prest tells me that the quality of the first drafts of personal statements submitted has been very encouraging. We continue to receive really thoughtful and thought-provoking project work from pupils, and we will celebrate some of what has been produced across Year 7 to 10 in our special assembly next week. Wishing you all a wonderful and productive week.
The end of the school year is always one of transition for students, teachers and parents alike. Whether preparing to start school for the first time, a change of school, perhaps a move from infants to juniors or primary to secondary, or for you older students, a transition into higher education or your first tentative steps into your career. Whatever the transition, for all involved, this is a time of great change. You will have heard said many times that as human beings, we're conditioned to dislike and even resist change. Ever since I was a young child, I was one of those who at my worst would fear change and uncertainty and strive to keep the status quo. The irony of this is that I have spent my career teaching business students the importance of business leaders being able to adapt to change in order to ensure the survival of their business. Never before has the business landscape been more volatile, uncertain, complex and ambiguous than it is right now. The reality is that change is inevitable, unavoidable, a normal part of life that can provide opportunities for us to grow and develop our resilience. The impacts of COVID-19 will be far-reaching and long-lasting, with the only thing being certain that things will continue to change at an extremely fast pace. Life will be uncertain, chaotic, and for many of us, uncomfortable for a long time to come. But it is in the discomfort that we must become comfortable, because it's here that our opportunities to succeed exist. So how do we handle change to be as smooth and worry-free as possible? Firstly, we need to acknowledge the change. It's an important thing to do when change is happening. Accept that it's happening. Accept that it can be good. And this is one of the first steps to dealing with it. Secondly, face your fears. Change can be scary. So if you're worried about it, write down your worries. Think about what you can do to overcome them. Confront your worries. Ask for help. Speak to family, friends, or teachers about what your worries are. They'll be able to help you handle the change and negate your worries. Try and replace your worries about change with something positive. Embrace it. Look at change as a new adventure. Think what new opportunities this change may have for you. Fifthly, communicate. Communication cannot be underestimated. So communicate, communicate. You got it, communicate. It's always as important, especially when you face change. Continue to do your work and your day-to-day activities. It's so easy when things are changing to sit back and see what will happen next. But rather than take a rest, think about the bigger picture. the bigger picture of your educational journey, your journey towards being the success that I know each of you will be. What were you born to do? Though my personal belief is that no one was born to do anything. You can actually do and be whoever and whatever you want. Life may well be too short to just be a lawyer, an accountant, a teacher. And indeed, research has shown that young people today will have 5 to 7 career changes and up to 19 jobs by the age of 42. How many careers do you want? More importantly, what else do you want to accomplish? As for me, in the year 2000, I started a new job and moved into a new house. In January 2020, I left that job to start my career at Rossall. This summer, I will move out of that house and onto the Rossall site. I'm excited, but the truth is, change is inevitable. It can be frightening, it can be disruptive, but with the right attitude, outlook, and actions, you can find opportunities in change. I am excited for the future, and my message to you all this year, facing transition and change, is to involve and embrace change.
So going in school was obviously a lot different to being at home. It was a lot more interactive, and it was nice to see our friends again and do stuff that we're used to doing at school.
Great. Fantastic. And William, what was your favourite part of the day?
My favourite part of the day was probably our biology lesson in the beginning, because it was nice. It's nice because we went outside. We were able to just relax. We learned quite a bit. We also got to relax by like the sea and stuff.
Mm-hmm. Lovely. Thank you. Martha, what about you? What was the best bit of the day for you?
Probably the art session in the afternoon, because the environment was just, it was nicer to be with your friends and stuff like that, and to see the teachers even and get some help.
Brilliant. Thank you. And Taylor Daisy, now you came in on a day when there weren't many people there. How did the food lesson go?
I loved doing the food, making the chocolate cake. It was great. And I really enjoyed doing all the practicals as well, because when you're doing it like on Zoom, you can see what's going on, but you don't really understand it as much. So getting your hands on it and stuff, like, you know, is better.
I went into school on Friday last week, and I really enjoyed it because I got to see my friends and my teachers. We had a biology lesson and we did a physics practical, and we also had PE in the afternoon, and it was really enjoyable, and I'm really glad that I went.
St. Teresa of Avila was a young lady who wrote a wonderful little book called The Way of Perfection. But St. Teresa of Avila was notorious because she was thrown out of a convent. She challenged the nuns to change and reform. She did it in such a way that they resisted it so much that they threw her out. One night they asked her to leave in awful weather, were in only the clothes she had on, up with a horse and cart outside, and off she went. And eventually the horse and cart bolted and threw her into a great puddle of mud, and there she sat. And it is said that while she sat there, she looked up to heaven and she said, "Lord, if this is the way you treat your friends, there's no wonder that you don't have many." I mean, of course, the reason why the sisters threw her out and asked her to leave was the fact that they simply could not cope with the demands she was making in terms of reform and change. Some of the great change makers of history have made the world feel a very uncomfortable place to be. I think of people like Mahatma Gandhi or Martin Luther King. In our day, perhaps the Black Lives Matter campaigners, who are demanding that we take down statues and, as it were, change the way in which we view people from the past. All of this makes many people feel uneasy. None of us likes change, regardless of who we are. And yet it's vital if we're truly to live life. After all, ask the dragonfly. All of us are called to embrace change. It's the only way. The key, though, is how to embrace it. How to manage. How to cope with the change that will ultimately transform us. Well, I believe Christianity teaches us that God has promised never to leave us. And in fact, God goes before us as a torchbearer in life. So not only does he stand behind us, stand alongside us, but he goes before us, lightening the path. Embrace change. It's inevitable. God, grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change, courage to change the things I can, and wisdom to know the difference. Amen.
Must have been.